Konnichiwa. Pleasant day to everyone. Last week I made a video about installing the first Linux distribution that I ever used, back in 1995. For balance, let's take a look at installing the most recent Linux distribution that I have used, which is Debian Buster. For a reasonably fast installation, I decided to download the installation DVD directly from internet. The downloading took about 8 minutes, but I have sped up this downloading footage so that we can move on. The actual installation will be happening in a QEmu virtual machine. First, I created a blank 16GB file that simulates a hard disk. The QEmu command line is a bit complicated because I had to provide the list of all hardware that my virtual machine will have. I will go with a basic text-based installation because of reasons. First, the installer asks me to choose the language and locale settings. I chose to use the US English settings for everything, except the time zone and the keyboard layout, which I want to be Finnish because I live in Finnish time zone and I use the Finnish keyboard layout. At this point, the installer retrieves network configuration software from the installation media, which is the DVD disk image I downloaded starting at 15 seconds into this video. Why this software is not already installed in the installer, I don't know. In any case, after loading, it attempts to auto-detect network settings, which it does successfully. Then it wants a name for the system. I just used defaults for the sake of the video. After that, we move ahead into creating a superuser account, which is nearly always called root in Unix-style operating systems. As far as I know, it has nothing to do with the biblical name Ruth, or the late Dr. Ruth Davis, or Professor Ruth Aylett. My root password for this video will be 1234. For the disk partitioning, I chose to do things manually rather than using the automatic scheme. The automatic scheme insists on creating a swap partition, and I don't want one. So what I will do is create a small boot partition in the beginning of the disk, and then create a LVM volume group for the rest of the space. From the volume group, I allocate a single large partition for all the files. One of the advantages of LVM is that it makes it really easy to migrate partitions between different disks, or even to extend them across several physical hard drives. I always create one for the root file system. When your root file system is on an LVM, it becomes possible to plug in a new drive into your computer, migrate the root file system into it, and then remove or repurpose the old drive without having to reboot the computer a single time. Try doing that in Windows. When I finish setting up the mount points and I tell the installer to go ahead, it still takes one more opportunity to remind me that I should really create a swap partition. Nope, I do not want one. My computer has 32GB of RAM and I will plan to use ZRAM to make it last even better. And the installer lets you do that. Much like the C programming language, which goes hand in hand with the history of the Unix operating system, Unix-like operating systems like Linux or FreeBSD usually permit you to do whatever you want. But modern usability guidelines dictate that they should at least warn you when something you are planning to do might be something you end up regretting. This philosophy can still be seen here and there in Linux. Now, as for installing an operating system, it is rather rare with Linux that you actually have a physical media from which to install Linux. Or let me rephrase that. It is rare that you have a physical media from which you upgrade a Linux distribution. I may be biased because I have used Debian for so long, but the standard way is that you set up network access and tell the package manager where to find the closest Debian distribution site and then simply stop worrying about it. All of the system upgrades after that will happen through the internet. With Debian, you basically have two options for the distribution. You can either set your package manager to track distribution by some particular name, such as Potato or Jesse. These names correspond to some particular release of the Debian distribution. Or you can follow one of the three official branches called stable, testing, and unstable. Each of these is a moving goal, where upgrades happen rather seamlessly, and you don't really need to worry or even know about distribution versions. As long as you upgrade your packages regularly, you always have a relatively new Debian distribution. And there are never large jumps like from Windows XP to Windows 7. More often than not, the distribution can be upgraded without rebooting, or even without having to stop and restart any of your important running software. There are exceptions, like when upgrading the Nvidia graphics driver, you may find that OpenGL programs no longer run properly before you reboot. But those are rather exceptions, not the rule. Next, the installation wants me to select which software to install, or well, mainly just choose the desktop environment at this point. I used iSWEM for many years, but nowadays I prefer Cinnamon. I also disable the print server that I don't need, and enable the SSH server that I want. Then the package manager begins installing all the software. Because I cannot possibly think of anything interesting to save for a full 5 minutes, and I seem to have a case of morning voice anyway, I sped this footage up by a factor of 10. I actually wanted to have a VHS fast forward video effect here, but I could not find anything in KDE Live that looks good enough. I know most people would use something like Adobe After Something for video editing, but I am an advocate of free and open source software, maybe a little cheap too, so I use KDE Live, which is free and reasonably full-featured. For the final part in the installation procedure, the installer asks where to install the bootloader. No longer does it ask which bootloader to use, everyone uses Grub, it is a no-brainer. The installer reboots the computer, and we are ready to launch Debian. And exactly 4.0 seconds after pressing enter in the bootloader, we are presented with a graphical login screen. However, because of problems pertaining only to the virtual machine and how it handles screen updates, I got a blank screen the moment I tried to resize the window, and it seems I have no choice but to reboot the virtual machine. Which I did. 3.65 seconds after pressing enter at Grub, we are back at the login screen. Let's see if I can still remember my password. I think it was 1234. And here we are, at the Debian desktop. It has taken us 27 minutes and 24 seconds to get to this point, including the time spent downloading DVD, rebooting the virtual machine, and so on. Straight out from the box, we can run a web browser, Firefox. Let's see whether we can go to YouTube. Imagine this. Witness the marvels of modern technology. Right now you are watching a YouTube video in which a person installs an operating system to watch a YouTube video in which a person installs an operating system. But before we meander any bit further in the exploration of the mysteries of modern software technology, I will take just a moment to customize this user interface to my liking. There, the Bluebird window borders and the Blumenta taskbar themes. That's all that I need for now. What is my desktop resolution, by the way? Okay, that is all very good. Now I do not like this white terminal very much. People always ask me what is the font that I use. Well, watch very closely. I am about to type the font name right now. And there it is. This is the bread and butter of my Linux experience. A gray on black X-terminal. From here all the magic happens. All of it. Now I apologize for the sudden cut that is about to happen in the video. I thought there was something wrong with the network connections in the virtual machine, and I spent about 5 minutes troubleshooting it until I figured out that the user mode networking layer in QEmu just does not forward pings. I cut that part out. So these are the repositories that the Debian installer put here. For convenience's sake, it still refers to the DVD so that it does not need to load everything from the internet if the DVD is available. I do have GCC, yes? Which version do I have? GCC 6.4. That is good. Let's try compiling something. Something from my website. from one of my earlier videos. How about the NES emulator? I am fast forwarding this a bit because it took some effort and time to figure out which ROM to test this with, because this version did not have any keypad input and I needed the game that starts producing sound and animated video without pressing any key. In the end I went with Mega Man 2. After that I decided to run the portal rendering thing just for fun. This is the simple version that was shown in the video. But there is also the version that does textured walls and light maps. However, because I did not have the lightmap files at the website, the program will calculate them in the beginning. Because it took about 24 minutes to calculate just one round for all the lightmaps using my highly inefficient program, I decided to do something else while waiting. The purpose of all this is twofold. Personally, I was interested to learn what kind of things actually are possible and which are not in the QEmu virtual machine. QEmu is neither DOSBox nor is it Wine. It is not designed for things like playing games. But it is getting better and better every year, and even gaming might be possible in the virtual machine. And the second reason is that I wanted to document in the video just some things that are possible in Linux and even easy. Unlike Windows, Linux is a natural environment for the programmer, with an extremely powerful shell at your fingertips, no matter which distribution you installed. And world-leading and best-known compilers like GCC and Clang thrive in Linux. I already know that Steam works fine. I play many Steam-based games in the host computer frequently. But I wanted to see how does the situation change when running in a virtual machine. Looks like at least Steam's 10-foot mode works just fine. To my great surprise, RimWorld did not run at all. I even tried running it from the command line, but I could not find any possible way to run it in QEmu. So the next thing I tested was Half-Life.
Good morning, and welcome to the Black Mesa Transit System.
But there was a problem. For some reason I could only look at the floor in the game. Vertical mouse control did not seem to work right. I could not tell whether this was a problem in the mouse emulation or in the graphics emulation. It ran just fine in the host computer, so whatever the cause, it had something to do with QEmu. In any case, several minutes later my little program finished calculating the rudimentary lightmaps, and it launched the rendering and it looks as follows. So long story short, installing Linux today is nothing like installing Linux was 20 years ago, as evidenced by my last week's video, and we did not even cover things like support for photo cameras or accessibility for impaired people, which have improved by leaps in the last years. So what do you do with Linux? Post in the comments, share your stories. Try out Linux. I think you can even install a perfectly functional Linux distribution on a USB stick if you lack the hard disk space, or if you are afraid of intercompatibility with Windows. My computer actually has Windows 10 as well, and there are no problems dual booting to either operating system. You cannot run them both simultaneously though, except through virtual machines. Thanks for watching. If you wish to support my channel, one of the best ways to help my channel grow is to share my videos on social media. Have the most peaceful and revitalizing day. If it's night, well, have the most peaceful and revitalizing night then. Until next time, bye.